Good morning. Happy to be here. Welcome to San Diego and to the Neuroscience Meeting of 2016. I'm Holly Klein, the president of the Society for Neuroscience, the field's largest global professional society. It's going to be a great meeting this year. And I'm pleased to announce that as of this morning, our meeting registration is 28,777. That's a great start. So I'd like to thank the hundreds of Society for Neuroscience volunteers who have helped to organize and participate in building this year's annual neuroscience program. They've developed an outstanding array of exciting and emerging science. The program also offers an array of professional development sessions, satellite sessions, social events, and advocacy forums that advance individual careers and the entire field. The Society for Neuroscience has designed this annual meeting program and all of our programs throughout the year to serve you, the membership of the Society, and to also serve the larger community. Together, we're a global community of world-class researchers, and we're tackling one of the science's greatest challenges to understand the structure and function of the brain. In addition to welcoming longtime scientists and leaders in our field, I'd like to place a specific invitation and thanks to the postdoctoral fellows and students who are here from countries around the world. You're the next generation of leaders who will drive the future of this field. We welcome you, and you need your perspective and your excellent science. In addition to the annual meeting, the Society serves you and your science throughout the year with many vital programs. Each afternoon during the meeting, I'm going to briefly highlight the value of the membership, and I want you to understand all that you can get from being members of the Society for Neuroscience and how it will enable you to become part of this community. With your help, the Society aims to be an essential place to connect with your colleagues, to learn new science, to advance your careers, and to unite to advocate for strong neuroscience funding and responsible use of animals in research. So let's go on to today's exciting event. This is the annual Dialogues Between Neuroscience and Society, and it promises to be a very unique and exciting beginning to our meeting. As you entered the hall, you probably noticed that staff are handing out cards, and they'll continue to distribute these cards throughout the talk. The way this event is going to be organized is Dr. Shikhar Saxena will give a talk for about 45 minutes, and then we'll have a panel discussion to extrapolate on some of the points that Dr. Saxena mentions in his talk, and then we'll end with a question and answer period where you have the opportunity to pose questions to Dr. Saxena. So what I encourage you to do is to write your questions and points of interest on the cards and pass them to the staff who will be in amongst the audience. And then moderators will summarize those questions and pose them to Dr. Saxena. So at this point, I'd like to thank Elsevier for its generous support of this lecture series, which was created to explore ways that neuroscience interfaces with other elements of our world. And the intent of the series is to have experts from other fields join us for an insightful discussion about how we can further our understanding of the brain. So past topics in this dialogue series have been about architecture, computers, dance, economics, mental illness, art, and food. And this year, the focus of this talk is going to be global mental health and neuroscience. The fast advancing study of the brain has broadened our understanding of mental health disorders and has raised new issues about how care and treatment can be provided to people in communities around the world. And it once again demonstrates the importance of neuroscience in the daily lives of people around the world. It's my pleasure today to introduce our guest speaker, Shikhar Saxena, to talk about the relationship between neuroscience and mental health. Dr. Saxena is a world-renowned psychiatrist with 30 years of experience in research and program management, service delivery, and information systems in the areas of mental health, especially in low and middle-income countries. He works for the World Health Organization since 1998. He now serves as the director of the Department of Mental Health and Substance Abuse in the World Health Organization's headquarters in Geneva. He's also joint leader of the Mental Health Innovation Network. He's contributed notable writings to the World Health Report in 2011 and to the Lancet series on global mental health in 2007 and 2011. Dr. Saxena led the implementation of the World Health Organization's Mental Health Atlas and Assessment Instrument for Mental Health Systems, now being used in 80 countries around the world. He also implemented the World Health Organization's Mental Health Gap Action Program, which is designed to strengthen care for mental, neurological, and substance abuse disorders in low and middle-income countries. He's currently tasked with leading the organization's efforts to implement the Comprehensive Mental Health Action Program, a resolution adopted in 2013 that enhances care for priority mental, neurological, and substance abuse disorders. I had the pleasure of meeting Dr. Saxena at a conference or an international delegation in Cuba, and there he raised the topic of how neuroscience can interface with global mental health issues. So I'm very pleased to have Dr. Saxena join us today, and the title of his lecture is Global Mental Health and Neuroscience, Challenges and Opportunities. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Shikhar Saxena.
Thank you very much, Dr. Klein. A very good morning to all of you. It's my distinct privilege and pleasure to be here. It indeed is a dialogue lecture, so I hope that we will have a dialogue and there will be better understanding and possibly even better action. I'm also very pleased to be in this city, San Diego, which is one of the most beautiful cities that I have visited. Yesterday, I took a short walk, not very far off from this conference center, and I took a few pictures. One of them is right here. It's indeed a very, very nice city. What I intend to do in the next 40-45 minutes is to talk about the impact of mental disorders, the investments in mental health, recent global commitments, investments in neuroscience research, as I understand, obviously you understand that much better than I do, some challenges and opportunities, and possibly some next steps. I'm very pleased that I'll be joined by three panel members along with Dr. Klein. And although Dr. Klein did not say that, I hope that they take all the most difficult questions that you pose. I work for the World Health Organization, so I'd like to begin with the definition of health from the World Health Organization. And I just want to say that this definition was developed in 1948, many, many years back. And it included health being a state of complete physical, mental, and social well-being. The emphasis is mind, and not merely the absence of disease and infirmity. Mental health is an integral part of health, and it deals with mental and social well-being along with physical well-being, and they cannot actually be separated very well. That is the feeling with which I come to a group of people who deal more often with physical health, but have very much and can have potentially very much impact on people's mental and social well-being. Integrated it within the overall concept of health as we see it in WHO. I also want to say that mental health is far more than psychiatry. It is a multidisciplinary branch. It includes psychiatry, but it also includes many social sciences like psychology, anthropology, and many other social sciences, along with neurosciences, which contribute a lot to mental health and can contribute even much more. Psychopharmacology and many other areas. It is also about prevention of mental disorders and promotion of mental health besides treatment of mental disorders. And it is also about normal behavior as such. We need to understand normal behavior before we can well understand the behaviors which are signs and symptoms of mental disorders. Mental disorders are eventually, I believe, brain disorders with manifestations primarily in the domains of cognition, emotion, and behavior. This does not exclude the influence of environmental factors, which for many diseases may be predominant. And from WHO's side, I would like to make a plea that we need to look at mental, neurological, and substance use disorders within the same domain. Actually, in WHO, it's the same department that looks after these three broad categories of disorders. I'm aware that many countries don't do that. I'm also aware that within the research field, there are these segregations, but I think this is the dialogue that we need to promote and to deal with them in a holistic way. The impact of mental disorders, indeed, is extremely large. Look at the numbers. Schizophrenia, 23 million. Bipolar disorder, 44 million. Depression, the biggie. More than 300 million people suffer from depression. Similarly, for anxiety disorders, alcohol use disorders, drug use disorders, dementia, and epilepsy. Not only the numbers are large, they are increasing. For 15 years before 2000, for 10 years before 2015, there is a substantial increase in the numbers of people with these disorders. Obviously, part of this increase is the increase in population numbers. But a major part is also because these disorders are becoming more common and are being identified more often. You will see that the largest rise is in the prevalence of dementia. And that's obviously also because we are an aging society. And as more numbers of people become attain older age groups, dementia is becoming more prominent and is going to continue to have a much larger impact on societies simply because of the numbers. Do they cause death and disabilities? Well, they do, and a lot of it. Disability-adjusted life years lost is one of the metrics by which the impact of disorders, whether from the area of mental, neurological, substance use, or from any other area, malaria, tuberculosis, HIV, hypertension, all of these are measured using the similar metric. And you will see in red color the neurological disorders on the DALI side, which is 3.5, and mental and behavioral disorders, which is 6.6. Obviously, not a very large contribution. But as you look at the other pie chart, years of life lost because of disability, these two increase substantially. They are more than 25% of the total disabilities, which is measured by the life lost to disability in terms of numbers of years. And mental and behavior disorders suddenly become much, much larger. So these disorders cause death. They also cause a very large amount of disabilities. In terms of age, these disorders arise typically during young adulthood. You see the top part of this chart, which is mental disorders, they peak between 15 to 25 years of age. It's the young people who should be living a life free for disability, should be contributing to society, Socially, economically, they carry the burden of mental disorders. Similarly, for neurological disorders, again, there is a peak around the young, one in children, second in young adulthood, and then again at the extreme age, in the older age group, there is another peak. So again, these disorders arise in the younger age group and continue throughout the life. Substance use disorders are typically disorders of young age. So these disorders create this kind of mountain of burden, which is indeed a very, very major problem for our societies. Look at suicide. 800,000 people die because of suicide every year in the world, and this number of death is larger than the number of deaths because of malaria or breast cancer, globally as well as in many, many countries. We hear so much more about breast cancer and malaria and so much less about suicide as a cause of death. Indeed, it is a hidden epidemic. This number is much larger than the total number of lives lost because of wars, conflicts, and disasters every year. And this is one of the leading causes of death amongst young adults. Suicide indeed kills a very large number of people in every country, whether it's low, middle, or in high-income countries. And that's something that we tend to ignore. There is one death because of suicide every 40 seconds. There is also excess death amongst persons with severe mental disorders. They die not only because of suicide, but they die because of many other conditions. On an average, the life span of people with severe mental disorders is shorter by 15 to 20 years. And this is because they suffer from cardiac illness, pulmonary illness, cancers, and many other physical illnesses. One, because they themselves don't look after their health very well. Second, because the society does not care for them. A symptom by a person with mental disorder is often taken as a sign of his mental disorder. And that is a big mistake. We ignore them till the time the diseases become much larger and they kill them much earlier than they should die. And this is, again, a scandal in the current society. We allow them to suffer because of their mental disorders, but also to suffer because of their physical disorders, and they die much earlier. Besides the health part, disability part, there is the economic burden of mental disorders. One of the studies done by the World Economic Forum and Harvard, not many years back, calculated and estimated the cost of illness, the direct cost as well as the indirect cost. And in the year 2010, the cost was what you see on this visual. There are just too many zeros. At least my mind cannot wrap around this figure. It's not millions, it's not billions, it's trillions of dollars as a total cost, the total global cost of mental disorders in a year. It's $2.5 trillion. And this is increasing. The estimate was that by the year 2030, this will become $6 trillion. It's a huge cost. None of the countries, whether low income, middle income, or even a high income country, can have this cost covered from their budgets. This is a cost to countries, this is a cost to societies, this is a cost to families and people. This is extremely high economic cost. In World Health Organization, we certainly take health as more than wealth. For us, health is something which has a value in its own right, but we know that many people count health in terms of the dollars lost. And even for them, it is a very solid case. If there is no health, there is no wealth also. There is an estimate for several countries for the economic burden. This particular example is from China. The total annual cost is more than $88 billion, which is 1.1% of China's GNP. And the direct cost will be much more if all patients were treated. We know that many, many patients are not treated in China, but also elsewhere. There is a third aspect, the human rights abuses. They are common. it's a global issue. It's a myth that human rights issues are there only for low and middle income countries. They are everywhere. They are in terms of involuntary hospitalization, which sometimes last many, many years, sometimes lifelong. Many of these people in mental hospitals do not need to be there at all. They are cast there because society cannot care. They just put them in the mental hospitals, and these are still, in 2016, there are still asylums in many countries where people with mental disorders are there because society does not want them outside. There is also incarceration in prisons, seclusion and isolation within homes, denial of basic amenities, discrimination in school, in workplace, and exclusion from social life. These are flagrant human rights violations which are there against people with mental disorders. There is the additional factor of wars, conflicts, and natural disasters. There is a substantially higher prevalence of mental disorders in people who are affected by these calamities. In year 2015, there were 65 million displaced people in the world. And we know this number actually is much larger than any time after the Second World War. We are displacing a very large number of people. And we know that this is a major stress factor for these people becoming more prone for mental and behavioral disorders. A high proportion of these people who are displaced are children. And we know that there is evidence that there could be long-term mental health consequences to a child who suffers from involuntary migration, denial of education, denial of basic amenities, which these people have all the time. If this is the large impact of mental disorders, what are the investments that we are making as a society? In WHO, we publish from time to time Mental Health Atlas. We published the first one in 2001. We published the last one in 2014. And Atlas tells us that we are not investing well enough in our mental health. The human resources out of all the resources for, out of all the workforce for health is just 1% if you count globally. And 45% of the world's population lives in a country with less than one psychiatrist for every 100,000 people. These are figures that are just not adequate enough to look after the large number of people who have mental disorders. There is a large gap between the burden and the budgets. In this slide, the largest bars are for the disabilities in calculated in terms of ILDs. The one which is lighter than that is for DALIs, the overall burden. And you see the tiny bars in the lightest color. These are for the total health spending, total mental health spending out of the health spending. Even high-income countries devote only 5.1% of their total budget, total health budget, on mental health. And this proportion goes down very rapidly as we go from upper middle to lower middle to low income. It's 0.5% of the health budget which low-income countries devote to their mental health. Their total budgets are smaller. Their health budgets are also small. And even out of those small health budgets, they are devoting only 0.5% of their budgets into mental health. This buys nothing. That's the reason why we are not doing enough on mental health. We just need to invest more in our mental health. If the countries don't have money, is there bilateral aid? Is there international aid? This chart, which is a little bit complicated, but it just shows that out of the total developmental assistance for all areas, for education, for humanitarian issues, for climate, for anything, how much is devoted to health, and out of that, how much is devoted to mental health? It's been, for the last many years, it's been less than 1%. This 1% limit is something which is plaguing the area of mental health all throughout. Countries don't spend, the development aid doesn't cover at all. So these are figures which really we should be ashamed of. If we count the global health burden versus the development assistance in low-income countries, we see here a chart which compares HIV with mental health. On the top part, there is the burden, disease burden, because of HIV, which is in green, and mental health, which is in orange. Mental health is larger. And on the lower part, you see the proportion of developmental assistance for these two areas, and you see the comparison. Mental health becomes so much smaller than HIV, which actually causes much more burden compared to HIV. I have nothing against HIV. It's a terrible disease. We need to be looking after that very well. But it's just that the contrast is so glaring. We are ignoring mental health as countries, as communities, and globally. You might ask, what is the return on investment for mental health? Why should we invest if there is no return? Is it money down the drain? No. One of the studies that we were part of, published earlier this year, is counting the return on investment because of depression treatment. And you see here the total investment needed for depression in the world for selected countries is $91 billion. And the return in terms of productivity and in terms of value of health is much larger than that. And the total cost comes out to be $91 billion for these countries, and the total benefit counted in terms of productivity and value of health is $488 billion, giving you a return of more than five for each dollar spent. Even for a person who's not an economist like me, this makes good sense. And still, we are not doing that. The result of all of this, high burden, low investment, is treatment coverage. This is a study which is about to be published by some of the colleagues. This is based on World Mental Health Surveys in 21 countries. These data are only about major depressive disorder. Minimally adequate treatment defined in a particular way was available in high-income countries only to 22.4% people, and in middle-income countries only by 11% of people. In low-income countries, it's less than 4%. This is the extent of treatment that is available for depression in the world. These figures should again be something we should hang our heads in shame for. There is a report from Mental Health America just published last month, which says 40 million Americans have a mental health concern. It may be a disease, it may not be. And out of that, 56% of adults still don't receive treatment. This is happening right here in USA. There are 1.2 million people with mental health conditions currently in prisons, and the lack of access to mental health care is linked with higher rates of incarceration. However, the situation is not all bleak. There are recent global commitments, and let me just mention two of them. One is the WHO's Mental Health Action Plan 2013-2020. WHO, for those of you who may not be aware, is an international agency concerned with health. It's a part of UN. Every year in May, all the ministers of health come to Geneva and deliberate about what are the priorities for health within the year. And in 2013, they developed the WHO's Mental Health Action Plan, and they approved it, all 194 countries. And the four objectives of this plan are to strengthen effective leadership and governance for mental health, to provide comprehensive, integrated, and responsive mental health and social care. See here that it's not only mental health care, but also social care, and in community-based settings. To implement strategies for promotion and prevention, and to strengthen information systems, evidence, and research. You'll be very pleased to note that research is certainly on the agenda for global mental health, and ministers of health approved this mental health action plan with very clear actions for themselves, for the WHO, and for the civil society. Also, the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development, passed by the United Nations, has for the first time very clear mention of promoting mental health and well-being. This is an agenda not approved by the ministers of health, but approved by the prime ministers and presidents. So certainly, mental health is increasing in its visibility and commitment all across the world. Let's come to an area which you know much more about than me, the potential contribution of neurosciences. There are a number of brain research initiatives. This particular article, which was published just 2 months back, summarizes the advances in brain research, at least from 6 major brain initiatives. There is the one which is in USA, the brain. It's one of the objectives is to find new ways of to treat, cure, and even prevent brain disorders. The European Union project to gather, organize, and disseminate data describing the brain and its diseases. The project in China, the project in Latin America, and also one of the initiatives which I like to mention, which is led by NIMH, an experimental classification system with substantial implications for research, including for neurosciences, as a first step towards precision medicine for mental disorders. These are advancements which are very major. These are investments which are in billions of dollars, and we hope that these do come out with something tangible for the global mental health area, which has so much need. There are also very major advancements in individual diseases, like autism, schizophrenia, substance dependence, depression, and dementia. However, at least I'm not aware of a diagnostic test that can be used for any of these disorders, which can be widely used in all countries, including low-income countries. I haven't seen a new class of drug for any of these disorders in the last 20 years, perhaps with an exception of dementia, where the pipeline is really very strong. In other disorders, I can't say that. And also, the pharma companies apparently are decreasing their investments in this area because they don't find the investments lucrative enough and the risk-reward ratio good enough for them to invest more. This is the situation as I see it. And I'm very happy to be contradicted. If you come and tell me this is not the real issues, these are not facts, I stand here to be corrected. What about challenges and opportunities? I've identified a few, and I'm again very happy to have a dialogue on these. One issue is interdisciplinary collaboration, neuroscience and mental health. I still see separate departments, separate journals, separate conferences, and separate funding sources. How long will we continue with that? The collaboration seems to be improving, but much more is needed. And not only in a few countries, but in all countries. For example, are neurosciences investigating the impact on brain of psychological interventions? I still need to see much more on that. So there are proactive efforts needed for interdisciplinary collaboration, and also professional associations like this can play certainly a very substantial role on that. My second issue is global collaboration. More than 90% of scientific studies are from and about high-income countries. Now, that is not being global. Even when we are talking about international research collaboration, it's between high and other high-income countries. We are ignoring a very large number of people living in this world. And this can be and is a real impediment to science. If we don't know what is happening in the brains of the majority of people living in this world, can we really advance science in the best possible manner? Can we still say that we know the human brain? And at least my answer will be no. We wrote a small commentary just this year on action on mental health needs global cooperation, along with a colleague of mine, Pamela Collins. And one of the sentences that we wrote there was, when it comes to mental health, all countries are developing countries. I believe that. A country that does not look after the treatment of more than 50% of people with depression living in that country. A country that allows 1 million people to stay in prisons when suffering from mental disorders. Is it a country that can be called a developed country for mental disorders or mental health? You answer that. We have to learn a lot from each other, from across the countries, from across disciplines, and from across the areas which we are ignoring so far. We also, of course, need increased investment in research, increased public, private, and philanthropic investments. We need better partnerships between these investments. I'm not aware of, perhaps that's wrong, maybe just a couple of investments are made by philanthropic foundations on neurosciences and mental health, but much more needs to be there. We need also increased connection of research with public health gains. Unless we can demonstrate that the research is going to benefit public health in the most tangible manner, in more immediate manner than we have been able to demonstrate so far, we will not have the public with us. We also need some innovative mechanisms for investment. For example, social contracting of research in terms of social bonds, pre-negotiated returns, underwriting arrangements. These are all innovative financial mechanisms that perhaps can be used much more than have been used in the area of neurosciences and mental health research. Perhaps there have been many grand challenges in neurosciences. Perhaps we need one for finding out mental health interventions that can be applied globally. We also need a very large public awareness initiative on brain projects as they should benefit mental health. We need generation of new knowledge. We certainly do, because we don't know this organ called brain. But the question is, are we using the knowledge that we already have? And at least my answer is, we are not using the knowledge that we already have in the most proper manner when it comes to global mental health. And there has to be a better balance between discovery and translation into practice of what we know. We also need better prioritization of research investment by focusing on solutions that can be scaled up rapidly and globally. We need public health priorities to guide the research investments, and we need problem-solving research to be prioritized. We need very careful prioritization of research efforts, and we need to consult all stakeholders in this prioritization exercise. And one stakeholder group that is often ignored is persons with mental and brain disorders. Are we asking them what are their priorities? Are we deciding our research based on what they would like us to do? Because we are part of society, we serve them. And I must remind here ourselves that a very large proportion of investments going into research are funded from public monies. Taxpayers somewhere are paying for that, and the taxpayers need to decide what the research priorities should be. Another area which I'll just touch upon, because I know that many people, including the people in my panel, know much more about that: harnessing the potential of technology and artificial intelligence, including machine learning. The world is getting connected. This chart shows that a very large number of people, almost the entire world, is getting connected with mobile network coverage, including internet use. In fact, it's a very sad truth for us in World Health Organization that more people have access to mobile network than to safe water, which we do believe plays a lot of role in their health. But however, harnessing these is something that we need to take as a challenge. There is need for evidence-based diagnostic and therapeutic IT and AI-based applications. Just some possible examples, and I'm sure there are many, many others. Diagnosis of depression and early dementia with speech, facial features, and gait analysis, especially when tracked over a period of time. We have the technology to do that. In fact, we have the data that can actually be used right now for checking the progression of a person in terms of speech, in terms of facial features and gait over a long period of time. And that can actually demonstrate very early changes, which suggest the person might be going through depression or developing dementia. Routine tracking of emotions and well-being. Just like we measure our steps that we have taken every day or the stairs that we have climbed, can we develop something which tracks our emotions and behavior and eventually well-being over a period of time for the person knowing himself or herself, what's going through in his or her mind? video games to delay cognitive decline in degenerating disorders. There are some very, very good studies that at least I was able to read, and it's an area where we really need to invest much more. But we also need a global or national agencies for accreditation and certification, because there are a lot of things that are happening which certainly are not evidence-based. We also need increased public and private partnership on that. The area of big data is something that I don't understand fully, but certainly there is enormous potential, but also substantial barriers in terms of legislative and privacy issues, in terms of ownership and profit considerations, and also very practical barriers in terms of data harmonization and maintenance of that. We certainly need a non-conflicted global and national leaderships on these things. I come towards the end of this presentation with the few next steps as I could imagine, and I'm sure we will develop much more in this dialogue. Developing a succinct case for more investments in neuroscience research related to mental disorders with near-term benefits for public health. Perhaps a grand challenge on neuroscience research for mental health and public awareness initiative along with that. Development of public, private, and philanthropic global partnerships with clear time-bound goals. Enhanced collaboration between large brain projects for mental health interventions. A careful analysis of progress made in brain projects to identify results with near-term practical utility. And to attract perhaps on public mental health aspects of neuroscience major conferences and congresses. This is a good trend. I hope it continues. My wish list. I'm not very sure whether this is actually the wish list I should be presenting, but I thought I'll just give it a shot and maybe we can develop it more. An early diagnostic test for autism. We would love to have that. Every parent who suspects their child might have autism needs that and need that right now. A disease-modifying intervention for dementia, even if it can delay the decline in a person's cognition as well as behavior by 6 months, it has enormous potential for people's well-being and for economic savings. A biomarker for bipolar disorder is schizophrenia, a new generation of drugs for schizophrenia, low-cost telemetric EEG with AI machine interpretation, because we know that there are telemetric EEG analyses, but we just don't have the trained personnel to analyze them. Finally, IT and AI-based interventions for anxiety and depression. This list could be very, very long, but I just thought I'll point out a few things which at least I'll be happy if they are developed. I leave you with a saying that was said more than 200 years ago. Knowing is not enough. We must apply. Being willing is not enough. We must do. Thank you very much for attention.
Thank you very much, Dr. Saxena. And so now I'd like to invite the panelists up to join us on stage. They are Steve Hyman, the past president of the Society for Neuroscience from the Broad Institute, Huda Akhil, another past president who is at the University of Michigan, and Tom Insel, previously at the NIMH and now at Verily Life Sciences. So what will happen now is, we'll carry on a little bit of a discussion, extrapolating from some of the points that Dr. Saxena made in his talk. And afterwards, we'll have an open question and answer period. Please give your comments and questions to the staff in the aisles, and our moderators will then formulate those questions. So let me just tell you in advance, the modulators are Eric Nessler, Sophia Jorgensen, and Marissa Roberto. Thank you. All right, well, thank you for being here. Let's see, Huda, maybe you can start out by talking about how what Dr. Saxena has said might extrapolate to people facing large forced mobility. Forced mobility, migration.
Yeah, I mean, the Shekhar Saxena's talk really pointed out not only the enormous costs of these disorders, but the fact that the incidence is growing, and they're growing partly for demographic reasons, good demographic reasons, populations are getting older, but they're also growing for horrific demographic reasons, which are all of these displaced people. And I think the question for this audience is how can we as neuroscientists perhaps make a difference, maybe in the near term, but certainly in the longer term. So conditions that are influenced by these forced migrations are many, but most obviously post-traumatic stress disorder, where neuroscientists are beginning to get a bit of a toehold, but maybe some people in the audience would be interested in having some experiences in this real world or out in the field and seeing what's happening to people in ways that could help think about monitoring or, you know, treatment is complicated. That takes many, many years, but ways of engaging and understanding the human biology. But these individuals beyond PTSD go on to have major depression, and there's longstanding good evidence that that young people who are engaged in forced migrations or as refugees have vastly increased risk of schizophrenia, where the level of early stress might interact with neurodevelopmental systems and pruning. And again, I think some part of this community might have some very useful ideas about it.
Thank you. And then another point, I think, Tom Insel, you would be really the best person to comment on how modern technology can help with this global mental health recognition and treatment.
Well, thanks. The first thing I'd like to say is to congratulate Shekhar on what I think was a spectacular summary of where the field is right now and what the challenges are. A part of that that I was most impressed with was this enormous gap between what we're currently doing. I think the slide was that 45% of people live in countries with where there's less than one psychiatrist per 100,000, and that it's about 1% of healthcare expense in the low-income countries. So it's hard not to be just blown away by that enormous disparity and the huge challenge that confronts us in trying to fill that gap. I don't think that's going to get filled by training a lot more psychiatrists. And I don't think it's going to be filled by even what we often talk about within the community of extenders or ways of doing task shifting. That will help. But certainly one of the great opportunities that you talked about, Shekhar, was this, the fact that so many people are currently accessing information online. The United States, we have about 190 million smartphones in use. Globally, it's about 2 billion. Enormous change from where we were even 5 years ago. And the opportunity to use that device as a way of both diagnosing and providing care is almost unique for mental disorders. We can't do that so well for heart disease, diabetes, cancer. We can do aspects of it. But one of the things that makes mental health almost unique within healthcare is the opportunity to use technology, particularly smartphone apps and wearables, for the entire cycle of detection, intervention, coordination of care. That could be transformative. And I think that is a way in which, as we look forward and we ask, to go to your last slide, what can we do now with the knowledge that we have now? There's an opportunity there that we ought to be thinking about, not only for the developed world, but for the developing world as well, where there are now communities in which people have phones and have internet access, even when they don't have clean water and they don't have consistent power sources, they still find ways to get their phones charged. So having that profound change in the ability to access a global population is an extraordinary opportunity to think about how we can do much, much better than the slides that you showed.
Huda, you were talking earlier about the stigma associated with mental health disorders. Would you like to talk about that more?
Yeah, so first, I want to start by thanking you, because you're right, this is shameful to all of us as humans, how badly we treat and pay attention to the people who are unlucky enough to develop a brain-related disorder, and we add insult to injury. Whatever they've inherited, their life gets just worse and worse because of the way we all respond to them. I wanted to just mention that for me personally, what you said was very meaningful, because I am from Syria, and a lot of those images of displaced people are people from, some of them from my family's hometown. And I really resonated with your point about how much or how little there is aid in the mental health arena. So even if you're trying to send money and say, I hope some of this goes to help people who are under severe stress, there isn't a mechanism that I have found to make sure that some of the donations are not just going to help people's physical injuries, which are, of course, really critical, but those kids, those images we have seen of kids stunned, losing their parents, or displaced, or in refugee camps, or having lost all sense of future, or dealing with parents with no future. So to me, this is very real and personal, and I hope we can do something about it. So now, again, based on my cultural experience, my feeling is both stigma and response to mental illness take on culturally different appearances. And I actually wanted to ask you how that, in your experience, how that plays out, but also whether you think we should be paying attention to that as we look at challenges and opportunities into the future.
Thank you very much, Huda. I think that's an excellent point, and I think this really adds to the information that I was giving in my presentation. It's about brain, but it's not only about brain. There are certainly cultural factors, there are environmental factors, there are traditions, and the way we are brought up that really has a very major influence on our psyche, normal and sometimes abnormal. And these are aspects that cannot be ignored. So even if eventually we understand everything about brain, it will still not fully answer the question why two people have different cognition, different emotions and behavior, and why even diseases, well-known global diseases, behave in a different way in different parts of the world, in different cultures. So certainly that's an aspect that needs to be focused. In our own work, we know that there are some evidence-based interventions which are applicable globally, but still the way they are implemented, the way they are applied for real people changes as you go from one culture to another. And these are important aspects that we should not forget. Otherwise, we'll be giving the same medicine to everybody with very different kind of results.
So it's culturally precision medicine in a way.
Exactly. I think you're absolutely right. It has to be precision medicine, individual and cultural, and also based on which stage of the problem the person is. And I think we are at this time very primitive. We just don't know well enough to do that. But that should be the goal. That should be the inspiration that should guide our work.
So, these are really important points. And many neuroscientists, of course, went into the field because they were interested in how the human mind works. But, of course, we can't see that. We see people's behavior. And part of the stigma is attributing volition, self-control to people who might be addicted or might be having a manic episode or might have complicated issues with impulse control. These are not all or nothing, which makes it even more difficult. And I think Tom and I were talking at the end of your wonderful talk about, from the point of view of mental health, we're all developing countries. When you think about in the United States, the way we've closed these admittedly terrible warehouse mental hospitals, but then failed to provide realistic community treatment and support, and now imprison, a very large percentage of people with psychotic disorders. I mean, it's been said that some of our larger prisons are actually our largest mental hospitals, which is a grim fact because, of course, there's no treatment and there's a lot of violence. I mean, one of the things we've been unable to do is to make visible, in some sense, whatever that would mean, I don't mean necessarily with imaging, but to make salient and visible to policymakers, to law enforcement, and to society in general, the fact that these are real ills of a real organ, the brain, and that these are not simply people misbehaving or being bad. And I think that this misattribution of volitional control associates with the strangeness and other aspects of stigma to lead to maltreatment. And here, it's not simple, and it's not simply rhetorical, but I think we as neuroscientists can contribute to making these conditions more real to policymakers and citizens.
Yeah, I think, Steve, I think that's a great point. And one of the ways in which to frame this, I liked Shekhar's use of MNS, sort of putting mental disorders, neurological disorders, substance abuse all together in a category that fits within medicine. So imagine if I told you that the largest institution for the treatment of breast cancer was the LA County Jail.
Yeah.
You'd say, that simply can't be, right? And I think we have to begin to put these in a medical context that helps people to understand that these are real disorders with real treatments, and that what we've been doing is not only an injustice, which we wouldn't permit for any other medical illness, but it's incredibly expensive and it's ineffective. We do have real treatments for many of these people. The problem is right now there's no alternative. They end up in jail because there are no beds, there are no other entities in which to send people to get the care they require, especially in an emergency situation. So we've got some work to do, and this is about really building out a system of care that just doesn't exist in this area of medicine, which is extraordinary. I don't know if you point to this as a form of stigma. I don't like that word. It's kind of a victim word. But I think if we talk about it as discrimination, as injustice, and it's just a kind of unacceptable form of inequality, that becomes actionable. And then there is a way that people involved with policy can begin to see steps forward to fix it.
This is the classic example of systems failure. The system is failing here. And we need to very clearly face that fact and let the policymakers at least do something about it. I think it's our duty as scientists and public health professionals to point out that this is something which should be unacceptable. The solutions will differ from country to country, from society to society, but no society in this year should accept it as, as something that they tolerate. It should be completely out.
So I have to confess, I think that in some ways at NIH, and Steve and I sort of share this legacy a bit, we haven't maybe taken that on in the right way. Much of what both of us argued for our tenures there, which now spans like 18 years or something like that, is that we don't know enough. and that we have to make these investments to really understand in a deep way what is schizophrenia, what is major depressive disorder, what is autism, sort of like your last couple of slides there. I'm afraid that we weren't clear enough about the opportunity to do so much more with the knowledge we have today. And if I had a regret about the way we communicated what we were after, it's that we've failed on this side of it. I think we failed to say to people, you know, what we're doing today is unacceptable, and we don't need to have all the genes that contribute to schizophrenia before we fix this. We need to begin to look at how we can take today's treatments, today's diagnostic tests, and even the limited understanding we have today, which, by the way, exceeds where we are in many other areas of medicine, and begin to deploy that in a way that makes this part of medicine and not some kind of social problem that gets dealt with in the criminal justice system or the homelessness system or some other part of our society that isn't really functioning for the people who need the help.
So I actually have a question in terms of your perspective on where the pressure points might be to move forward. So obviously one argument is that governments aren't committed enough, societies don't seem to want to invest enough, and we all seem to together be discriminating against people who are suffering from these disorders. Do you think, and from your point of view, there are a set of strategies that can be used to change that, not just by campaigning at the level of governments, but at the level of ordinary people, families, schools? Where do you see strategic approaches, especially where knowledge from a society like this one might be helpful to deploy?
That's a great point, and I come back to what I was saying with a little bit of correction. Policymakers move when citizens demand that. Mm-hmm. That's very clear in every country. And I think in this case, the civil society is failing to demand something which is much better than what it is now. So increased awareness amongst everybody, and then coming out with solutions that could be suggested is really very much needed. You know, we have the example of HIV and AIDS. Things happened when people demanded a better deal. That's and things did happen.
That's right.
So that's something that we need to do. Unfortunately, a few good examples are there in the recent past. Some celebrities, including in this country, have come out saying, yes, I had a mental health issue, and I sought treatment, and I got better. Those are great examples. We just need thousands of them and not one or two.
Shekhar, let me take a little bit of issue with that. I think we've all said that increasing awareness is going to be important, and for people to be able to talk about it is important. An example I like to look at is where we are with suicide and suicide prevention. You showed extraordinary numbers, 800,000 in the world, and you pointed out that there are more deaths from suicide than malaria or breast cancer, which are just, you know, that's an extraordinary observation that I think most people don't know. In the United States, the most recent numbers are about 43,000 suicides. There are about 39,000 breast cancer deaths. So again, it's certainly many, many more deaths from suicide, which is usually related to mental illness, than from breast cancer, prostate cancer, HIV. You can go down the list. I mean, it's an extraordinary public health issue. One of the things that is perhaps the most salient about that number is that it's trending up at the same time that you're seeing lots of these other metrics going down. The one that's most striking is homicide. So homicides have come down almost 50% in the United States. You wouldn't know that from listening to the news, but the fact is the rate now is about half of where it was 20 years ago. The suicide rate is actually higher. Fatalities from traffic accidents, down about 40% in that same period of time. So you have to ask that question, why have we failed on suicide where we have actually succeeded quite well in these other areas? And to get to a point that you made in your lecture, and I think something that you probably would agree with me about. One of the issues here is there's no one held accountable for suicide deaths, at least in the United States. If homicides start to go up, the mayor will lose his or her job. There'll be a change in the district attorney. There'll be a change in the sheriff, the police, all of these things that happen because we put an entire criminal justice system in place, which is held accountable for fixing this problem. You could make the same case for what happens with traffic fatalities. Those begin to go up. Someone knows about it. Someone's accountable. And yet, if you were to go to almost anyone in governance and say, what are you doing about suicide? Very, very few people would even know the numbers. They wouldn't have any idea that this is even an issue that's happening on their watch. No one is held accountable. I don't think anybody's ever lost their job because of an increase in the rate. And egregiously, we don't even know the rates for suicide in the United States until about 2 years after the fact, because those numbers take a long time on a national level to filter through the CDC. So we can give you the rates for 2014, but unlike the deaths from HIV or the deaths from homicide or the deaths from traffic fatalities, I can't tell you what happened last week or last month or even earlier this year. So there is a need to really change the game here in a fundamental way, I think, if we want to see the public health impact of what we know now actually be put in place. We need to have numbers, we need to have people accountable, we need to put a system in place that requires that.
Tom, I fully agree with that, but there are some countries which have made a lot of progress on that.
Right.
And in the case of suicide, Japan is a country that took this extremely seriously. They maintain their statistics week to week, and they are doing something about it. So it was increasing till a few years back, but now it has plateaued, and it's actually coming down a little bit. So there are some experiments and some experiences that can actually teach us. And I can tell you, in Japan, a few people did lose their jobs because the suicide rate was very high in their district.
Right. So if I may, I had to ask you a question about that. Somebody asked me this recently, and you're the perfect person to respond to this. In analogous to what you just said about suicide, if you had a child who was 17 and having a psychotic break, what country would you want to live in to get the best care?
Ah, that's a difficult question. Let me change it to say, if I had to have a psychotic episode, where would I like to live?
All right.
And my answer will be, not in a very highly developed society, because the gap between my capacity and what is expected of me will be higher. So I would like to live in a country where a certain amount of disability is actually accepted. However, intervention should be available. That's a difficult country to find, but I will try to do that.
Okay.
Okay, one more.
That's great.
I think that is an amazing statement, because it really speaks to the importance of the social support and the family and the expectations and the pressure we put on people. And we haven't had a chance to say very much about how those social factors actually change the brain, might alter the course of the illness, and how we might actually engage them and show people, even in very disadvantaged situations, that they have some powerful tools that come almost for free if you understand the culture and the place and you have the right knowledge and you put them together. To me, that's part of the translation. It's not just about highfalutin stuff, but about framing some of these questions with our neuroscience knowledge and our, you know, general health knowledge, to show people that thinking about the problem differently and then deploying the local resources might make a very big difference.
Thank you very much. Now I'd like to have the opportunity for you to ask questions of Dr. Saxena and the panelists. So if, I can't see very well, if the moderators would select a few questions. Let's start with you, Eric. Thank you.
Several audience members asked what basic neuroscientists can do to get directly involved in promoting better mental health policy, both in the United States and globally.
Mm-hmm. That's for you.
Yes, there's a lot that they can do. First is, let them see if their basic neuroscience research can have certain outcomes which are not very distant, but somewhat more near term. Let them find out if there is a clear link between what they're doing and how it can lead to some good public health benefits in near term. But the second thing, which is also quite important, is to increase awareness about these disorders being brain disorders and educate the public about the importance of their work for looking after the public health implications of mental health. That's an enormous job that all of us need to be doing.
Can I add one thing, Holly? Just very quickly, I think it's probably not as clear to many of the people who are in the room that if you're a neuroscientist, it's likely you're working in a university. And unlike any other area of medicine, if you're in a university, the demographics here in terms of illness are all about mental illness. That's a slide that Shekhar showed, that this is the onset is generally before age 25. So one way to, I think, contribute is to look at home, you know, to look at where you work, to find out more about what's available for students, because those are the people who are going to be most affected by this group of disorders. And they're probably getting really mediocre care, often care that's completely separated from their medical care. And that's a place where you can begin to make a change.
Marissa?
So we have talked about how we are behind in coping with the mental health disorder. So the audience asks, which country actually have adequate management of the mental health disorder? And if so, if you can provide us with some example of this country, what they are doing well to achieve that.
Thank you very much. I think none of the countries is ideal, but still some countries are definitely doing better than others, and they are of course investing a higher amount of their budgets on that. I don't want to name too many countries, but the Scandinavian countries are doing well, Australia is doing well, Canada is doing well, USA is doing well for some people.
I don't know if my microphone is, yeah. There's an interesting example from Australia where some of my colleagues have a collaboration. There are administrative oddities that everybody in the audience knows. When their kids grow up and reach the age of 18, they lose their pediatrician and they have to find adult medicine, and the same thing happens in mental health care. But of course, as you've just heard, the age of onset of a lot of these disorders, including severe psychotic disorders, is often in mid to late teens. And so there's a discontinuity in care systems. And with interesting leadership in Australia, they've managed to hold on to kids with mental health disorders from childhood through at least the age of 25. And that might sound like a simple administrative reform, but it actually makes that continuity makes an enormous difference. And yet, you know, the hardest thing to change are practice patterns, cultures, but surely we can accomplish things like that in many countries around the world.
But let me also just say that it's not only the high-income countries. For the effort that is being made, many of the low and middle income countries are actually doing very well. Yep. And as I was saying in my presentation, there is a lot to learn from each other. Countries like Ethiopia, countries like Sri Lanka, yep, are doing extremely well within the resources that they have, which is really something that a lot of countries can learn from.
Sophia?
Dr. Sazina. As neuroscientists and researchers, we are so used to looking at mental health issues from a molecular, genetic, morphologic perspective. But a lot of the questions came through trying to touch upon some of what Dr. Hudakil mentioned as the more holistic human component of mental health. such as, social, psychological, even existential aspect. And there was even a term called spiritual health. And how, my question is, how do you see that we can contribute or bridge these fields with what we do to contribute to the future breakthroughs in that are going to come in mental health?
That's exactly why mental health is such a fascinating area, because there are so many aspects to it, and certainly brain size sciences contribute a lot, but there are many other branches that really contribute so much more to our knowledge about mental health, and that's what makes it so exciting. So I would say that even if you're working at a cellular level, subcellular level, don't lose sight of what else affects the human being, the brain, and even the cells eventually.
Thank you. Now I'd like to go through one more set, starting with Eric, Marissa, and Sophia.
Sure. Several audience members were curious about how the rates of severe mental disorders compare across the globe and whether there's a relationship with education and wealth.
Generally, the more severe the mental disorders are, more uniform the rates are across the world. The rates are actually more different for what are called the common mental disorders or the more milder form of disorders. And for severe, like schizophrenia and bipolar and severe depression, the rates are comparable. Within a country, generally it is the people who are poorer who have more severe mental disorders. And partly it is because they were poor to begin with, but partly also as the mental disorder advances, they become poorer. In fact, yes. Catastrophic health expenses as the reason for poverty and debt is extremely common. And that's again something that is not realized very often, because many healthcare systems as well as insurance systems are not following the parity principle. They really don't compensate for you for all the expenses that are there, even in the most developed countries. And that's where people become poorer as they face years and years of disability and mental disorders.
Marissa? Several people are interested in hearing your point of view on drug addiction and how do you see, you know, drug intake to alleviate other disorders such as anxiety? So do you see correlation? How do you envision to possibly cure the double aspect, drug addiction, anxiety, and other comorbidity disorder?
Well, substance abuse is also a very major issue all throughout the world, certainly much more in some countries compared to others. And there are many strategical interventions for that. There could be a strategy of controlling drugs, which in USA is very high on the public agenda right now. But also from the health side, we deal with what we call the prevention and the demand reduction, so that people do not take drugs and become people who are affected by drug use disorders, which is not there for all people use drugs, but a majority of them do become dependent on it. If you ask the NIDA director, Nora Volkow, she will say, drug dependence is a chronic brain disease. And I think that's true. Drug taking is not a disease, but drug dependence is a chronic brain disease. And there are certainly brain scientists, we need to find out the cause as well as the interventions for that. You also raised another issue of comorbidity. People who have depression, anxiety, and psychoses tend to use, and in many cases, abuse drugs. And that really complicates the brain terribly. They already have a problem, and now they're complicating the problem by using, abusing, and sometimes becoming dependent on drugs. And that really poses a very serious issue, and clinicians deal with it every day. whether to treat the psychiatric disease first, whether to treat the substance disease, substance use disorder first, or use both. This becomes really, really complex. And in this case, it requires very specialized treatment. In fact, we believe that a majority of mental disorders can be treated by non-specialists, general doctors and nurses. But in this case, a very specialized treatment is actually required.
But I think this is also a place where we as neuroscientists can make a contribution, because much policy, certainly in the United States, but not only in the United States, has treated substance use disorders primarily as willful and as law enforcement rather than medical problems. And again, this goes to the attribution of willfulness even for people who are addicted, which I think is well illustrated by the fact that there are well above 2 million people in the United States in prison, a very large number of them for drug-related offenses. Now, some of them might be coldly calculating drug dealers, but in fact, I think most of the people who get caught are people who are caught in this web because they're addicted. And, you know, again, we have to have humility. It's not good when a scientist tries to show up in a courtroom and is, you know, banging the table and saying, we know this and we know that. You know, there are certainly a lot of uncertainties. But by the same token, I think we can, as educators of the public, of judges and so forth, help people to understand the way in which an addicted person has lost control of their goals. And certainly they didn't sit down at the age of 15 and make a life decision, you know, I want to be a deviant, you know. But often we treat people that way. I don't want to go on too long, but there's, you know, this is very similar to mental health. Probably some of you remember there was this really horrific case in Colorado where a young man, and it's salient to us because he was a graduate student in neuroscience, had a severe psychotic break, and then took a rifle and murdered people in a movie theater. And then when the police went to his apartment, they found it intricately wired with explosives and so forth. This young man went to trial, and the prosecutors were in complete agreement that he had paranoid schizophrenia. But the argument that they made to the jury was that his crime was meticulously planned, and he hid his plan so he knew right from wrong. So he was found guilty on more than 20 counts of first-degree murder. And in Colorado, the death penalty is decided by jurors. Only one juror, but that's all it took, voted against the death penalty for this young man. So again, as an educational role, it is true that this young man cognitively was able to meticulously plan this crime, but was he actually in control of his motives? And these are not easy things for us to educate people about. But I think we really do have a role, not at the time of dramatic criminal trials and so forth, but in educating people about the complexities of the human brain and its relationship to thought and behavior. Because, you know, these injustices, I've given you some dramatic examples, but these occur every day.
Thank you. Sophia.
There were several questions coming through related to how being part of minorities and having issues with gender identification are a big contributor to mental health issues. So they want to know what is the WHO doing towards that?
Certainly, some of the bigger societal issues like race issues, minority issues, even simple issue like being very poor, which brings you a little bit on the periphery of the society. These are all stress factors, and the prevalence of mental disorders amongst these people is certainly higher than the other people. And that's why I did not refer in very detailed manner, but promotion of mental health for any society depends on decreasing some of these risk factors, the largest socioeconomic risk factors, as well as protection increasing and enhancing the protection factors that can actually work. And for many societies, it is much more cost effective to look after these big socioeconomic factors eventually over a long term, although not for short term, than to actually start treating people, because overall, societies which are more harmonious, less diverse in a way of disparities, are much better for mental health. And these are things that are dealt with in the Sustainable Development Goals for the UN. And each of these goals have to be seen with other goals. So when they talk about decreasing poverty, this will actually have an indirect effect on mental health of people too. So that's something which I think is very, very obvious. Thank you for raising the issue, which is, I thought, was not so near neurosciences, but certainly is a very important issue.
Thank you.
Can I comment?
Yeah, sure.
I like the way that the discussion has gotten framed about this being the whole mental and substance abuse disorder being a human right issue. And so all these issues that relate to human rights and how we treat each other as humans based on whatever characteristics we have are all continuous and they are all related. And I feel that a thoughtful biological perspective about the brain and the behavior and its role in motivation, volition, an enlightened perspective is going to be helpful on all of the fronts. How we label people, how we treat people, how we respond to them when they start behaving differently from expectation and the legal system and up and down the line. So I really appreciated the framing of it as so, and that I think to the question Eric asked, I think as basic scientists, we have an important role to play in showing that continuity between the very fundamental aspects of our biology and how it expresses itself all the way into those human rights.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Dr. Saxena and Dr. Insel, Dr. Akil and Dr. Hyman, and thanks to all of you for participating, and to our moderators also. Thanks.